What we gonna do right here is go back. Way back. Back into time.
It's time to kick it old school with a new school flair. Taking you back to a time where things felt good.
Wow! I feel good.
Welcome to Old Fashioned Health. Today is the day to take back your health. Old Fashioned Health is just the right place to do it. Your host, Alvin, is determined to make sure you are in good health inside and out. Now, the time has come for some good Old Fashioned Health right here on 1100 AM. Here's
Alvin!
Okay! How y'all doing, Atlanta? How y'all doing? How y'all doing? This is Alvin and DJ 90 in the house on the Old Fashioned Health Show. Good health inside and out.
What up,
man?
What up?
How you doing, man?
Hey, man, I'm good, my brother. How y'all doing, Atlanta? It's your boy DJ 90 once again on the ones and twos on the Old Fashioned Health Show. Chilling with my man Alvin over here, man. It's good to see you again, brother.
You too, brother. I tell you, man, my DJ have everything on point every time I come in here. They got sound system all crisp and everything. Man, we got a great show today. Great show today.
Oh yeah!
Remember we talked about yesterday, we got this book that these gentlemen are co-writers on this book called Manhood.
Yeah, man, I can't wait for them to come in.
They're coming in. We got brother Keon Reid is going to be here, and Jason Jerome McFarlane are going to be here, and these are some young brothers doing their thing, man.
Right.
So proud of them.
Right.
Yeah, it was actually 15 brothers. They got together, the author, and 15 additional co-writers that wrote this book.
Yeah, I heard. We talked about it yesterday about how
they're co-contributors is what I should say. They're writing contributors.
Exactly, putting all their minds together from different perspectives and different views. So it should be interesting.
Now you know who came up with the book?
What's up?
Our famous doctor. Jesus, did I just draw a blank? We always talk about the naturopathic doctor. We always have him to call in all the time. You know who the naturopathic doctor is?
The naturopathic.
Dr. Ellison. Yes. Calvin Ellison. He wrote the book. Dr. Ellison has written quite a few books. But he is the one that pulled this whole thing together.
Right.
With these 15 brothers to ask them to contribute a portion to the book.
Mm-hmm.
And it is amazing. It is really good. So I'm excited about having them here so they can explain to us their part and the action that they took in putting the book together.
Exactly.
And we're going to get a chance to talk to Dr. Ellison to tell us how he came up with this whole concept in the first place.
Right.
But so today it's Brother Keon and Brother Jason that's going to be here to tell their part on what they did with the book. So we got that happening here shortly once they make it in. I think they are kind of stuck in a little traffic, but they should be here in a minute. I think they walking on in now. Yeah, they were scared of the traffic there. So they all right. But yeah, so we got them coming in. And so we're going to do what we always do. We always start the show off with the Black National Anthem.
And why, brother?
Yeah, we're trying to get these HBCUs to start actively playing. Start listening to start playing the Black National Anthem. I don't know if you went to black school, right?
State.
Okay, well we got a little secret about this Black National Anthem. For some reason, our HBCUs don't like to play the Black National Anthem. They get mad about taking a knee for the flag, but they won't play the Black National Anthem.
Or they simply just don't know about it.
Or they don't know about it, right? And I went to black school. I went to Jackson State,
okay.
And I was in the band, and we didn't play.
Yep.
So now I'm trying to get all the HBCUs to start playing the Black National Anthem. So it's all about. I'm not gonna tell y'all who that is right now, but when we come back on break. If you read his bio, the stuff we posted, you know this is one of the fellas, but I'm not going to tell you who he is. But so we'll be right back. We're going to start the show off with the Black National Anthem. We'll come back. We're going to have Brother Ken and Brother Jason talk to us about this wonderful book and their part in it. All right? We'll be right back.
Lift every voice
sing till earth and heaven.
Life happens, and when it does, the law firm of Althea DeBar Johnson, PC, and Tamara Wood is the law firm people turn to for planning and managing their legal affairs and protecting their current and future assets. The firm specializes in wealth protection through legal services that include estate planning, probate administration, and guardianship. This law firm promises to be truthful and honest, provide personalized attention, and they are focused on results that best suit your needs. For a consultation, contact them today at 404-584-5555 or visit them on the web at adjpclaw.com. The law firm of Althea DeBar Johnson, PC, and Tamara Wood, helping you plan for today and for the future so you can get on with the business of living.
Rejuvenation for youthfulness and beauty is trending worldwide. People are getting laser hair removal, Botox, dermal fillers, skin brightening, tightening, lifting, and reshaping. SmartPlex ATL, a comprehensive medical spa, located in East Cobb, 4799 Old Town Parkway. You can also visit us online at smartplexatl.com. Dr. Alexander and his team enjoy pampering you while you receive customized treatments in a beautiful, calming, zen-like atmosphere. SmartPlex ATL, we are your Hollywood destination for exciting, youthful rejuvenation.
All right, y'all. Welcome back to the Old Fashioned Health Show, Good Health Inside and Out, here with Alvin and DJ 9D, and our guest has arrived. They in
finally
the house.
Came through.
Yeah, that traffic scared them, man. Shuck them up a little bit. Yeah, they shuck them up a little bit. But, yeah, so they in the house and everything now. So we're going to make sure that everything is good with them and get them started off. So I'm going to introduce each one of them. We have Brother Jason Jerome McFarlane.
Ooh, and, middle name.
Yeah. I'm on there because, you know, because by the end of the show, it's going to be J and K. It. You know what I'm saying? I'm just being professional to start
that's
the thing off.
That's right. That's
right.
We're
going to break it off in about 5 minutes. We're just going to get just initials on it. You know how we do it.
Yes, yeah, sir. Yeah.
And then we have Mr. Keon Reid.
Yes, sir. Also. Yes, sir. Happy to be here.
Thank y'all so much for coming. I'm so excited about this book. And thank Dr. Ellison for making this happen, have you all to be a part of this. And I appreciate it. So y'all good? Y'all here? Y'all good? Y'all
yes,
good?
Sir.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes, good? Sir. Sounds good.
All right.
Cool.
All right. So the name of this book is Men Magnifying Manhood. And we got two of the people here that are co-writers for the book.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to start off first with asking each one of them where you're from and how you got started. So, Mr. Kim, we'll give you a chance to get your breather in because you just can't. You just like.
I appreciate that. I slid in.
Just slid in. So Jason is here ready. All right, Jason. So tell us a little bit about yourself and your part of the book.
Gotcha. So for me personally, my name is Jason McFarlane. I grew up in the Washington, D.C. metropolitan area. I was born in D.C., raised in Montgomery County.
Okay.
Gaithersburg, anybody who know where that is?
Nope.
It's all right. You got to be from the area to know, but yeah. But I grew up out there, went to Morgan State, ended up leaving there, went to Florida for a little bit, was in the Orlando area, was going to school for engineering. Decided to kind of leave that alone, got into real estate sales, then got into car sales, and ended up getting into the insurance field, which is what I'm doing now.
Okay.
Ended up connecting with Dr. Ellison probably about a year or so ago. He had come to our church, Divine Visitation International Ministries, and with that, we had just built a connection from there. And when he had told me about this project that was going on, it's something that I've always wanted to get myself into and stuff like this. So it was just a perfect opportunity and a perfect time for everything to transition over. And I definitely jumped on it immediately.
Okay. Yeah. All right. So, Keon, you ready?
Brother Reid.
I am ready. I think I caught my breath. I'm happy we have fruits and water here.
Oh, yeah,
so, you know, I get refreshed and, you know, we get it moving. But, you know, really happy to be here with my brother Jason and Alvin. And so, unlike you both, perhaps, I come with international flair.
Okay.
I'm all the way from the island of Jamaica.
Oh, okay.
Yes, sir. Was born in Jamaica. I moved here, migrated to America, Atlanta, of course.
Okay.
When I was 12 years old, and then, you know, I've done most of my schooling here. Went to Georgia State, bleed blue, and then afterwards I went. And then, you know, I went to Emory University, K kept it local, and you got my master's degree in physical chemistry there. Okay. And following my chemistry efforts and endeavors, I've now transitioned to business. And so currently I'm a proposal writer at First Data, and it's the world's largest payment processing company. Okay. Outside of the, you know, the work field, I would say that, you know, I'm really active in my church, New Bethel International Ministries, over in Lilburn, Georgia.
Okay.
And I've been with New Bethel for over 10 years now, and I've transitioned into many leadership roles there, and now I'm currently serving on the board, as well as I'm the youth leader there.
Okay.
And so I'm heavily involved with the ministry there, and outside of ministry, probably the most important component of myself is my beautiful wife, Kishana. Yeah, yeah, yeah. She's not here with me today, but I have to shout her out, or else I'll be in trouble tonight.
Yeah. Well, you know, we appreciate you doing that, because we're gonna give our listeners the number in case they want to call in and ask you guys some questions about the book and what made you decide to do that. Y'all don't mind taking calls, huh?
No, of course, right. Of course.
So listen, if y'all want to call in and ask these brothers some questions about why they got started with this book, Men Magnifying Manhood, the number is 404-603-8770. All right, so first, Jason, tell me what part of the book did you write? What is your part about?
So for me, the chapter that I wrote was called Lost in Greatness. Mm-hmm. With that, I feel like with everybody, period, but with men in particular, that we're in a stage right now where there's a lot of attack that's going on people. Mm-hmm. Whether it be pushed by society or pushed by a business structure, there's just a lot of different things that are going on that if you're not paying attention to, it can go and slip over your head. But I think they're trying to make it so subtle that with that, it's over time, it's going to be a true problem if it's not caught and corrected soon. So it was definitely something I wanted to get involved with. And the loss and greatness for me is just because I felt like there's a great factor that everybody has. Like everybody has greatness within them.
Right.
It's just a lot of times people kind of get lost in the everyday thing of life, lost in, you know, the struggles that are going on, lost in other people's fears, lost in all of these different things. And it just kind of causes us to slowly put boxes and limitations on ourselves to where we're not able to or no longer want to go and chase after the dreams that we once had.
Okay.
But I think with me, there was definitely a time period where I was lost. And I think I've been blessed to be able to break through that time period and just being able to go and write a little bit about how I did it, pass that on to somebody else so that they can hopefully try to get through theirs a little bit quicker.
Okay.
Makes it a better situation for us.
How does it make you feel to be a part of a book where it's 15 brothers that had an input on the book?
Honestly, to me, I'm honored to be able to be one of them.
Right.
Like to me, like I was actually in church last night, and it was funny because I was they had started praying, and I just started kind of smiling because really, I'll say maybe around 3 or 4 years ago at this point in my life, this is the type of avenue that I wanted to. I saw myself being in right, and when I saw myself in that light, immediately in my head I was like, man, who's gonna listen to you? Nobody can go and get out of here. Right. And then last night I'm like, yo, like I didn't even remember this, but instantly it just popped in my head, and it was something that it's really just a blessing, man, to be able to be a part of this, to be able to be in this position at this point. It's really God, bro.
And what's the name of your chapter again?
It's Lost in Greatness.
All right, Keon, brother Keon.
Yes, sir.
Tell us about your chapter and what made you decide to do it.
No, of course. I would just really like to start and say thank you, Dr. Ellison, because without his vision and the inspiration from God really and truly to call us and, you know, and gather all these men with unique stories, we would not have this project in place that's really a movement of men empowering men.
Exactly.
And so, you know, really appreciate Dr. Ellison. And, you know, I met him last December, and I'm really blessed that he saw fit to look into me and say, you know, there's something special that I think you would bring to this project. And, you know, reached out to me, and I was like, of course, you know, you know, because I really believe that with how we have been blessed as men and, you know, the experiences we've gone through, it's important that we pass that on to someone else.
Yeah.
And I think that also comes from me looking in my personal life and not probably seeing all the lessons or learning everything. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I really try to channel my personal story into the book. And so my chapter is called A Wasted Man.
Wow.
And so when I thought about my chapter title and, you know, Wasted Man, it wasn't really from the aspect that, you know, you have potential and ability and you've lost it. But I was talking to the core of a man. You're wasted if you don't tap into your potential. Mm. And so my story really talks about a personal and a really compelling time in my life. It was one of the lowest points, I would argue. And how I rose from that, you know, and how the key mantras from my chapter, action, consistency, and transcendence, really played a part in where I am today and where I will continue to go. Mm. And so the acronym or abbreviation means to act. And so as a man, we must act.
Man, I'm so excited about the book. So excited.
Right.
I want my co-host, Jerry, today, DJ 9D. Oh. I know he has some burning questions. When I told him about this book, I was like, man, this is going to be such a great interview. And we're going to get a chance to interview all 15 of the brothers.
Yeah, so, man. I can't wait.
First too. What's your first question?
I mean, I just wanted to know, you know, with all 15 brilliant minds together, was it difficult for y'all to, you know, come together at first? Because, you know, you have a lot of brothers out here that, you know, could be doing so much with their time. You know what I'm saying? That are lost. You know, what was the trials and tribulations when it comes to just coming together, sitting down in one room and just developing pretty much game to everybody, every man, no matter black or white? You know, what was that?
I can take it, just if you want. You know, we can tag team here. We're going to work together.
Yeah.
I think that, you know, it all stems back from Dr. Ellison.
Okay.
In that he had a vision and he has this spontaneous and contagious energy about him. And, you know, I think that when he pitched the idea to, I think the men that God ordained for this book and, you know, for any foreseeable projects, that they caught wind of it. And that more or less kind of drove us to meeting the deadlines, getting on conference calls, you know, meeting the deadlines for our chapters and, you know, reviewing, getting editorials, review and making sure that, you know, everything was in tip-top shape. And it's really because there's an urgency for helping men.
Right.
And so I think that across the sphere of, you know, the playing field that we have right here, we had great leadership in Dr. Ellison. Mm. And I think all the men bought into this project and this movement to really help.
And not to cut off, and I'm going to get to you, not to cut off, but I had it. I wish y'all wrote this down.
But, you're going to find it.
I got so many, but Lord. Just to answer that question.
No, you're good. I got you. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I think like Keon was saying, like Dr. Ellison, he's kind of the master brain around this whole project.
Right.
And with that, I think that he was able to choose a lot of people who are passionate about giving back to the community and passionate about trying to instill values in people and trying to see everybody grow.
Right.
So with that, for me, as soon as he told me about it, like honestly, I started writing before I even got all the information as to what we were completely doing.
Right.
You know
right.
what I mean? So I think once you had everybody that had personalities that were just so in tune with what was trying to be done and needing to see that growth in our communities, it was pretty easy for us to start working together.
The information y'all brothers wrote down, was it developed over time due to growing up, having older people telling you, look, don't walk through there because you know what's going on? Or was it something you had to find out for yourself, meaning like go through the experience of just being like, you know what, let me write this down in the book to give it, you know, to the future generation?
I think, well, for me personally, it was, there were people who were around to go and tell me yes or no. Mm-hmm. Like they would try to guide me in the right way, but me, I do what I do.
Right.
Like,
right.
So,
of course. I'm a man.
Yeah, I do what I do.
And that's one of the beauties of it because, again, you know, some people are told not to go through that and they do and end up telling the next person.
Yeah,
you know, better game. So,
it was for me. That was my experience. Like I did whatever I had going on, and with that, I had to face my consequences. And with me facing the consequences, I think everything happens for a reason.
Of course.
Like, and like you said, like it was your dark point in which you had written about.
Right.
It's like really in those dark points that I'm realizing that's where the most growth starts to take place.
Okay.
Right? And so with that, I'm happy about all of my experiences because of the fact that honestly, I've been able to learn a lot from them.
Mm-hmm.
And through that, maybe it was the line of communication that it was said to me, in which it wasn't really relayed for me to be able to catch it.
Right.
And maybe I can go and catch it in a different way and relay it to somebody else in a different way so that they could catch it at an earlier age.
Okay, that's what's up. Yeah.
I like to tack on to that. You know, one of the sayings I grew up hearing was, chew the meat and spit out the bone. Right?
Spit out the bone.
Right? And so what it's basically saying is that, you know, we all have information and we digest things. And so you know, have mentors and, you know, are reading or watching videos. And so you have information coming from all different aspects and areas throughout your life, you know, from your teenage years all the way coming up. And so for me, I think I've filtered some. I think I've choked on the bone a couple of times as well. And that's going back to Jason. You know, I think that we just have this innate nature. We want to go. We want to buck the grain and we want to learn. And so some of the show. Yeah.
Let me try.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And, you know, I think that one of the beautiful things about manhood is that through some of these mistakes come some of the most beautiful revelations and concepts and information that we can gather to retool and repurpose and help not only ourselves, but, you know, our wives, our family, the communities that we serve. And so I think that without other men or without being open to learning or reading or getting something for yourselves, you know, it wouldn't be possible for us to, you know, contribute at this place.
Okay, cool.
So what I think about the fact that you have 15 plus Dr. Ellison to get together, I'm wondering, what did you all learn about each other when you read? Because you didn't know what each other wrote, right?
No.
But you all read the book now, right?
Oh, I thought they did.
No, they don't know. So
that's even better.
So, yes, of course.
When you read Keon's story, part of the book, what did you think?
I think it was well written. I mean, it's everybody... period, like everybody, and they have their own little specific things that are there, so it's all completely different topics. You can see it's funny to see how some of these topics kind of overlap in certain areas, and you kind of see, like, with those certain areas, those are probably the key things that we all kind of deal with, but we all have to go through it through our different ways. So is everybody is similar,
right?
But we all have our minor differences or whatever that's to be able to make us different. So it was it was a good tool. I think I've learned a little bit about everybody.
Everybody.
And with that, just their own little touch on what they've been through, it helps me as well. So, okay. I mean, this is something that I think is a book that can help everybody. It's not just something that's geared towards, like, one person or one direct set of people. Like, anybody can read this and capture something from it.
Wow. Yeah. So, Keon, what did you get from Jason?
Men Magnifying Manhood. Jason Magnifying Manhood is absolutely beautiful. One of the things that I really appreciated was that, you know, I kind of tried to stay away from certain things in my life, you know, whether that's drugs or, you know, being incarcerated, whatever it is. Right. And walking through the book and the different chapters, you're like, oh, my gosh. This is one of my brothers, and he went through it. And, you know, I get to see through Jason's lens, you know, his issues and his family and how he walked through them and became a man. And and some of his experience, I was like, man, I didn't want to go through it. But then I get to see through his lens what were the challenges he faced there. And then I have my own personal story, and then they begin to see, okay, what was grad school like? You know, some people didn't go to college.
So
what are some of the challenges you faced there? And so that was really enriching. And what I like about the novel idea in the book is that we have a bio page and a profile page.
Okay.
So even before you jump into their story, you get a refresher, or you learn about the man you're about to explore.
Right.
Wow.
And so that's really powerful, even the keywords and it just positions you to just absorb before you even dive into their story, and that's just powerful.
You know, I tell Dr. Ellison often, the man, I don't know if he realizes how powerful he is when he put people together. And even this book, Magnifying Manhood, and 15 different guys with their own story, that's like a movie to me.
Right.
Yeah, that's true.
No, it's true. Watch a movie, I was like, oh, God, it's Keon. And then the next thing you face, and then you and Jason. And then you go to the next one. It's like, this is so, so good. A lot of times, African-American brothers are not given the credit for positive stuff.
Exactly.
True.
You don't hear about stuff like this. You hear about everything else, but you won't hear about this, that we got brothers, that 15 guys got together and wrote a story. about their lives to educate someone else. So yes. Man magnifying, men magnifying manhood mm-hmm. is absolutely a wonderful, yes. wonderful project. I'm so glad Dr. Ellison did it. I wonder, is it possible that could be a part two?
I'm not going to speak on other people's behalf because I don't know all the details.
Right.
But I would assume, and this is only off of an assumption, that with the
I don't know
the
how
impact that
two.
This is going to make, mm-hmm. I can see that happening in the future. I'm not going to say that it is something that's definite because I'm not sure, but I can see a part two coming down the line.
Could you do it part two?
All I got to say is we need a part two.
right. No, too much information.
Because I'm just saying, this is only 15 men.
Right.
And I would be hard-pressed to believe that we've captured the full scope mm-hmm. of challenges, triumphs of manhood.
Right.
And so I would love for there to be a volume two to this and getting different perspectives. You know, in our project here, we have men in their 20s going all the way up to their 70s that wrote in this book.
Yeah, I was going to ask you that. So yeah, what's the age range?
In the 20s, I think early 20s, okay. mid-20s, up into their 70s.
Wow.
And so this is a breadth wow. of knowledge and wisdom you're getting here. And so should there be a volume two? I want to hear what the teenagers got to say. I definitely want to hear what the teenagers got to say.
Yeah, that is really good.
I'm just stating this fact, man. That's what I'm talking about when it comes down to y'all book, because it's not only focusing on the youth. It's coming from different levels of age and wisdom and mm-hmm. and people in the stores. I love it, man. I can't wait to get a copy.
You
straight
know,
up.
I am going to try my best to get Dr. Ellison to include Jerry within the book. So one of the things about this guy, he's like 23, 24.
Oh, here you go.
And when I promise you, you would swear Jerry has been here before. The man has the most old, crisp spirit.
Dropping
these little old-fashioned. Like,
I'm trying to develop wisdom like y'all.
I know, right?
Man, that's all
we
I'm
just,
doing.
We just brush up on each other, man.
Yeah. Iron sharp as iron.
That's
man.
Right. That's right.
Yes, sir.
So the website, where would they pick up the book? Because we're going to take a break in a minute. But where would you tell them to go pick up the book?
For me, if you want to go and get one of the copies from me, you can find me on social media. I'm on Instagram and on Facebook. With that, you can find me at, what is it, Insurance Masterminds. I make sure. Yeah. But it's at Insurance Mastermind on Instagram as well as Facebook. You can reach me also through email, McFarlane, my last name, McFarlane, Jason, Jason, @gmail.com.
Okay.
And reach me there to be able to try to book any type of shows or anything like that.
Okay. All right. And
what about you?
Yeah.
Yes, for me, you can find me on social media as well. On Instagram, _KeonReid, that's _KeonReid. I'm on Facebook, Keon Reid, the handsome fellow you see there.
The most handsome one.
Yeah. I think I pop up in the top of the search, which mm-hmm. is good. I'm on Twitter as well. And, you know, of course, email keon.reid@alumni.emory.edu.
Okay.
I'll be launching my consulting service company soon. So you can also visit keon.reid.com. And so you'll be able to connect with me there for the book and other things.
Yeah. Well, we're going to take a break. When we come back, we want to talk about exactly a little bit about more about what you're doing in your business life currently. Mm-hmm. Currently, I know you're doing insurance and some other stuff probably. Mm-hmm. We want to talk about that. And then your project that you're personally working on.
I got a little bit something different today, Alvin.
I
hope you ain't mad at me. Uh-oh. I hope you know we got special guests in here.
We got hot fire. Right
yeah, man. I believe Brother Reid and everybody else will enjoy this thing.
Yes, sir.
Right
yes, sir.
Yeah, sir. Yeah, yeah, we play old school music over here, and I don't know how far back he's gonna go. Because here's the thing: I don't know the music that he knows. He knows the stylistics, and I'm like, I never heard of that before. He knows he all the old music, and I'm like, you passed Nita Baker and Luther. I'm about a little lost. All right, y'all. This is Alvin and DJ 90. On the Old Fashioned Health Show on the Real 1100.
Time it with you. It's lunchtime. You have yourself a nice sandwich, a cool drink, but something's missing. A fresh bag of chips. Symphony chips, to be exact. Symphony chips are homemade chips made with a custom blend of spices and flavors that you won't find anywhere else. Visit symphonychips.com to choose your flavor and locations to get your hands on a bag today. Symphony chips, because every bite should be harmonious.
All right, y'all. Welcome back to the Old Fashioned Health Show. Good health inside and out.
Yes,
this is Alvin with DJ 9D and my two co-writers here, Keon and Jason. See, I don't know just first name. Down with the last name. We already did that already. So I was telling you all when we came back, we want to talk a little bit about what you're doing professionally. But again, we're talking about men magnifying manhood. You all need to check it out. They can get it on Amazon and all those other places as well.
It's on Amazon as well.
Yeah, correct. But we're going to need y'all to make sure we're going to get to these guys' Instagram and their connection to make sure you get the book directly. A signed copy.
I know. I wish I would have ordered one because I would have had y'all sign it.
I can still sign, man.
They're going to leave us their book.
Yeah,
they leave us their book and their book going to sign. So we got us a book, man.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, we sure appreciate that. Sure appreciate y'all signing. Don't get no water on my book.
I got it.
So I was asking you guys about the impact that you think this could have on the climate or the of the country right now,
right?
With all the racism and stuff that's out there, and so two things: the racism that's going on, and the lack of leadership. At least it appears in our community. I don't believe there's a lack of leadership. For me, it may not be identified as Martin Luther King or somebody like that. But my leaders is when I see you and I'm saying, okay, I got to follow what Jason is doing because he's doing the right thing. My is Keon is Jerry. Those are my leaders. I don't have necessarily. It's who I meet at the time and then who I can be myself. So, I mean, just because you don't see my leader on television don't mean I don't have somebody that I try to
learn from.
Right.
No, Alvin, I think that's a very good point because there are leaders in the communities, leaders that we interact. Mm-hmm. The challenge that we face is that we're not unified, in my opinion.
Right.
In that, where's that one voice?
Right.
Where's the unity in that, you know, let's look at these issues that are facing our communities. Facing or pockets,
right,
and begin to make institution changes that really affect where we're going forward as a people.
Right.
And the problem is that, even though they're leaders, why are our kids still asking, you know, where are our fathers?
Mm-hmm. Right.
Why are the black women saying, where are our black men?
Mm-hmm.
And so, yes, I believe there's leaders, but we're not visible. And so I think the challenge comes now is that with what we've been blessed with and all the mediums of social media and outreach, how do we push it?
Right.
Because we have the substance, we have the resource. And, you know, God bless MLK, Barack Obama, but that was in the past. Who's going to rise up, step up,
exactly,
and speak today,
mm-hmm,
and speak into the future? And I think that's where we need to get to, transition from a place of, yes, we have the leaders, but let's start to speak now and let everybody else hear our voice. And, you know, in the break, Jason, I love what you said, is that when we start to speak, there's something come from the other side trying to shut us up, trying to keep us down,
you know?
And so we have to speak louder than the fight that we're getting.
Or the actions need to be louder than the noise that they're hearing.
There you go, sir. There you go.
Do you think it might be due to the fact of doing the right thing and end up still getting, you know, at the end of the road punished due to just speaking the word, telling the truth, trying to get to it? Do you think a lot of people in our community fear that part of just being a leader?
I think to an extent, yes.
Yeah.
But I think at the same time, when you're talking about men in general,
yeah,
the issue or one of the things that I notice is that we don't really speak.
Right.
Like
right.
I just realized that recently with my wife, she was saying half the stuff that was written about, she didn't know that that's what was going on.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So the issue is just that, like, for us, yes, we're here. There's enough of us, I believe, that are out here.
Right.
Yes, there's a large portion of us that we need to go and try to figure out how to get them involved.
Mm-hmm.
But there's enough of us that's out here for us to be able to really make some changes.
Right.
But we need to be able to speak about it and actually come together on platforms like this to be able to discuss and make things happen. And I think once we do start uniting and we are able to get our voices heard more and people see, like, our community see us being more active in the communities and everything we have going on, then you'll start seeing the changes.
Okay.
And we definitely need to see the changes. But
definitely.
Well, let me ask you this. Is it possible I'm asking you three guys that would include you, DJ Nine. Is it possible that it's kind of like at home, when you're home, before we all went to school, everything you was taught when you went to school, you didn't have to be told no more. You already knew when you get to school. It's like, okay, so I was taught I got to do this. I have to do that. The leader was back home, but you act as though the leader had already put something into you and know what to do, right?
Mm-hmm.
So when I run into one of your brothers on campus or somewhere, I know how to respect who I'm running into and to be helpful if you need me, because that's how I was taught at home.
Exactly.
So I kind of think sometimes society has, for some reason, made us believe that it has to be somebody with a mic and a podium to say, I am the leader.
Exactly.
But I don't have to have it, because the leader I had at home already taught me
what
I need to do when I run into whatever situation to be a blessing to whomever I should run into. So sometimes, you happen to get a Barack, you happen to get a Martin Luther King and all those kind of things that's fighting for a cause.
Mm-hmm.
But the leader still exists from home and abroad. You know what I'm saying?
Exactly. Now, Alvin, that is really powerful. And it brings me back to CNN Heroes.
Mm-hmm.
It's an annual award.
They're going to call me one day.
That's what I'm talking about. That's what I'm talking about.
They're going to call me.
No, it's really powerful, because when I looked at the idea and how it was birthed and what they're doing, it's people that we don't see every day.
That's right.
And they're affecting so much change in the communities and the lives that you're touching. And they're all across the world.
That's right.
Just by an idea and an initiative and being consistent with it, they're moving mountains.
Yes, they are.
And so, you know, I love the point that you said that, you know, our action needs to speak louder than the voice, because we're now in a situation where if we coalesce as men and start to really move in our communities, there's nothing we can't do.
Especially if you was taught right at home, you already know what to do. You know, my mother used to say, an empty wagon make a lot of noise.
Yes.
I don't need all that noise. I just need to see. Now, if I see Jason, if I see Keon, all you have to do is say, Alvin, can I? Oh, yeah, what you need? You know what I'm saying? So because it's first and second nature. But however, society and others make it believe that if one of you brothers call me, that I won't, because I'm afraid you're going to get ahead of me. And that's far from the truth. But that's what the myths and that's what the misnomers are.
Correct.
And I hate that, you know, because that's like, that's not how we don't act like you think we act.
Right.
You know, you got 15 brothers got together and wrote a book with no pictures in. And you know, they see the thing, it has some pictures in it. And it's educational. It helps you. But that I like the fact that this man magnifying manhood is really just killing the stereotypes. And lastly, I would say, speaking about a leader, it's not as many people know Dr. Ellison, right? But Dr. Ellison spoke, put it together, and now he's planted 15 seeds that are going to plant 15 more seeds.
Exactly. Correct.
And don't know anything about Dr. Ellison. You know what I'm saying? So the leaders don't have to be necessarily seen. They just need to be working.
Exactly. Yes, that's correct.
You know, they just need to be working. Yeah,
so that's the hallmark of an effective leader.
Yes, it is.
Right? We see the results of the fruit of everything that's happening in the background.
Yeah. I'm concerned about those leaders that need a check and need a mic every time. Just need it. I mean, I just need you to speak, and sometimes it ain't about the money.
Yes, sir.
You
know,
that's true. Yeah. You about to say something?
I was saying, you were talking about, as far as the leadership, I know for me that I have very strong leadership at home. But with me, it was a situation to where you know how to act here, you know what you can get away with here. And it kind of went on that way. So I think with us right now, and as building this coalition of men, it's very important that we kind of get people who are all in different fields and in different things, so that yes, I may not be home, but I'm out of school, but I know that Mr. Whoever. What I mean? So that accountability factor is something that's needed.
That's wonderful. Like,
we all need that accountability, because without it, it allows us all to start settle for being mediocre.
Yeah, we're going to kill these rumors and make people think that. No, we got leaders. You just may not hear them, but you will see the action.
Yes, sir.
You may not hear them, but you see the action.
Yes, sir.
Definitely.
We're going to take another break, because Old School has a song for you. He didn't already did a song for me.
Right.
Yeah,
right,
he did one for me. I appreciate that, bro. I appreciate it.
All right, y'all. We'll be right back. This is Alvin and DJ 90 on the Old Fashioned Health Show on The Real 1100.
Too busy. Girl, when we first started,
All right, y'all. Welcome back to the Old Fashioned Health Show. Good health inside and out. So my my co-hosts loved the story that I told yesterday, and there were a lot of people that listened to the story I told yesterday. We're here with Keon and Jason. Notice first names only, fellas.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
No one did that. So, yeah. And they are the writers, co-writers of, contributing writers of Men, Magnifying Manhood. And I got my own copy signed by both.
Yes, sir.
All right. So we were talking about leaders. And yesterday I was telling my DJ in the audience about a guy. It was a homeless man I met last Friday. And he walked up to me. He said, "Hey, listen, brother, I'm in the military." He said, "Can you help me out?" So I had a dollar, a $10 bill, and a 20, right? And I'm like, "Yeah, sure, you know." So you just usually get a dollar away, right? So I get a man, and I was like, "Oh my God, man, thank you so much for this dollar. Thank you so much for this dollar." He said, "Look, this is all I've gotten today," which was a lot of change. He said, "People always give me a dime and a quarter." He said, "You gave me a dollar. I really appreciate it." So I'm like, "Wow." But as I talked to him more, I noticed how articulate he was. It's like, wow. So I wanted to know more about him. So I asked him a little bit more about it. I said, "So, how long you been out here? How'd you get here?" He said, "Man, listen, I've been out here for 3 months." He said, "Before now, I had a 5 Series BMW, and I lost everything." He said, "He's suffering from PTSD and bipolar disorder." And he said the reason why he didn't have it anywhere because he was waiting on the VA to give him housing. So he just talking to me, telling me more. So, you know, I'm telling him a little bit more about myself. And then as I got to talking to him more, he started telling me all the jobs he had. He said, "But listen. He said, "Let me tell you something, man." He said, I asked him, I said, "What do you think about God?" Because I wanted to know, with him being in a situation, did he feel defeated? Man, that brother told me, he said, "Nope." He said, "Let me tell you about God, man." He said, "I so believe in God." He said, "God is good because he sent you today to give me this dollar." He said, "So although I'm out here, you may think I want to give up." He said, "But God is real." He said, "But let me tell you this about God for you." He said, "God told me to tell you to keep pushing. Don't give up. Don't quit, regardless to how bad it is, all the things you got going on. You are a blessing so much, brother." He said, "Amen. Let me tell you, man." He said, "Under the bridge, there's a bridge on Auburn Avenue."
Yeah.
He said, "Under the bridge," he said, "it's so many BS degrees, master degrees, doctor degree." He said, "So much talent out there." Yep. He said, "It's just, but they gave up." He said, "God told me to tell you, you cannot give up. Please keep pushing. Don't give up. You understand me?" And I'm looking, I'm like, so by now my eyes water, right? You know, I'm trying to get myself together because he didn't got me all kind of choked up, right? And then he said, I said, "Well, listen," I said, "let me give you what I want to give you at first." He said, "I understand why you think, because a lot of homeless people out here just doing a lot of things that are not, you know." So I gave him the $10 bill. But anyway, so toward the end of the story, before I won't take you through all this, before he got ready to leave, he said, "Let me tell you one more thing." He got ready to walk up. He said, "Please don't forget what I told you. Don't give up. God has told me to tell you to keep pushing. And you're going to be successful because you're a blessing to so many people." And then he waved his hand. He said, "I'm on my way back under the bridge now. I'll see you later." So those are leaders that you don't get a chance to.
Wow.
So then I'm crying and stuff on the street. I'm like, "Oh, my God, Grady going to come pick me up and take me." So I'm trying to get myself together. But, yeah, so but anyway, I had to tell y'all that story. I really appreciate you guys coming on so much. We are talking about the Men, Magnifying Manhood is the name of the book. We have Brother Jason here and Brother Keon. Real quickly, tell them your Instagram, Jason.
It's at Insurance Mastermind on Instagram and same on Facebook.
Okay, and Keon?
It's at _ Keon Reid, and that's _ KEONREID.
All right. And Men Magnifying Men, the editor of the book is Dr. Calvin Ellison.
And you can get your books where?
You can contact me on social media for either of those books. You reach out to me through email as well, McFarlane, McFarlane, Jason, at gmail.com.
Okay.
And for me, Keon, you can reach me on IG or Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, wherever you want to find me, KEONREID. You can definitely shoot me an email directly at keon.reid@alumni.emory.edu.
All right. Man, thank you all so much for coming. We appreciate you all. Y'all keep doing what you're doing. As Mr. Fred was the man on the street that I met, he told me to keep pushing, so I'm telling you all
keep
do the same
keep
thing.
Keep pushing. I appreciate it. Definitely.
Right. Thank you all for listening. Good. Y'all have a wonderful week. Man, it's Friday. I forgot.
Oh, man, it's Friday.
It is
Friday. All right. Y'all have a wonderful day, great week, and congratulations on what you've done.
Thank you so
thank
much.
Thank you very
I
much.
Thank you,
appreciate
DJ 90.
Hey, man. It's a pleasure to have y'all, boys. We're going to be doing more work with y'all as well.
Definitely.
All right.
Definitely.
Have a good one.
Peace.
Thank you.
Teach them. to love one another, that heaven might find a place in their hearts. 'Cause Jesus is love. He won't let you down.
Thanks for stopping by Old Fashioned Health with your host, Alvin. We hope this show has been informative and entertaining. And more importantly, we hope that we led you in the right direction to have good health inside and out. For more information on Old Fashioned Health, please visit our website at oldfashionedhealth.com. And be sure to join Alvin Monday through Friday from 4 to 5 p.m. for Old Fashioned Health right here on 1100 a.m. Take care.